like to welcome everybody today. We have several kind of returning guests. There's Karen, our namesake, and Shauna, which is Ron's daughter, and Nancy, who's been here, I think, one other time anyway. So be sure and say hi to them if you have a chance after church. Well, Dorsey's one of us. I'm not going to, she's not a guest. She's one of us. But we're glad to see you, Dorsey. I've been thinking about you and missing you not being here. I wanted to know if there are any prayer requests or maybe records of improvement on people from the prayer list. Okay. Another announcement is Sewing for Charity is this Tuesday at 11. No, excuse me. It's July 11. And we start at 9, and we're usually packed up and out of here by 12. And so anybody that's interested, you're welcome to come and join with us. Also, the third thing I have is that there is a new revised schedule on the table in the foyer. So if you haven't already picked one up, be sure to do that. Anybody think of an announcement before I quit? Okay. I'd like to offer a prayer for those people on the prayer list. Would you bow your heads and pray with me, please? Our most kind and gracious Heavenly Father, we lift up to you those people on our prayer list. Some of those individuals are so near and dear to our hearts, and others we don't know. But Father, each of their lives are important to someone, and especially to you. So Father, we would pray for your healing touch, for your comfort as they endure whatever their issues are right now. And for their lives, Father, we praise you and we thank you. And for your love and the power of your healing, we thank you and we praise you. In Jesus' name, amen. Okay, let's stand and sing our hymn of praise, I'm Gonna Live So God Can Use Me. I'd like to invite each of you to worship today. An invitation, like we get an invitation to a party or some event. I invite each of you to exhale and take a breath and imagine breathing in clean air full of the Holy Spirit, whom we have come to rest with this day. Jesus is described as the peaceful one. He modeled a life devoted to prayer and, of course, a close relationship with God. In our humanness, we often fail to be as close to God as we would truly like to be. A day like today is an opportunity to connect or reconnect with the one who is our Heavenly Father. And so my purpose is to invite each of us to worship today, to think again about our connection to our Heavenly Father and maybe gain a new insight into who we truly are and how we have and can serve Him. Let's join together now singing As the Deer, a hymn of quietness and centering as we begin our worship hour, and you may stay seated. Dear God in heaven, in the quiet of this hour, we pray that your Spirit will rest upon us in such a way that we can recognize its warmth and power touching us. We have come today expecting the grace of your love and look forward to experiencing its presence. Father, we claim the promise of your involvement in our lives. Bless each of us as we stand in need of in our individual places in life. Help us to remember to celebrate the love you have bestowed upon us. And I thank you, Father, for the willingness of your servants that have given their time and talents to share today. In the holy name of Jesus Christ, I pray. Amen.
Thank you. This morning's prayer for peace is called From Yearning for God by Carolyn Brock. It is easy to dismiss peace when we consider the suffering presence in human lives, natural systems, and creation as a whole. And yet, God invites us to a vision of hope. God reminds us that even in the midst of significant challenges, the work of reconciliation continues. We yearn for peace when God's yearning breaks open our capacity to see, to suffer with, and love. The deepest discernment question in our hearts needs to be, what does God yearn for? The enduring principles of community of Christ state it clearly. God wants shalom, justice, reconciliation, well-being, wholeness, and peace for all of creation. The larger goal of discernment is to recognize and join God's redemptive activity of restoring creation to wholeness and joy. May we pray. God of peace, we yearn for your peace. We yearn for your justice. We yearn for your action. We yearn for your grace. We yearn that you might restore creation. God of peace, you yearn for our peaceful way of life. You yearn for justice in our daily living. You yearn for action in our faith. You yearn for grace in our relationships. You yearn that we might restore creation. May we meet in this place. In the name of Jesus, the peaceful one, amen.
Well, it's really got a lot of reverberation, Roxanne. When I walked in on, must have been Thursday or Friday, and saw my favorite artwork, I knew I'd talk about butterflies. And our theme, well, let me back up a minute. This morning, when Eloise came in, she brought the Messenger, which was our newsletter back in 2002. And with it was just writing, I guess, writing, and I think divine writing from our pastor at that time, Joan. And when she came in, I said, Eloise, take a look at this, because this butterfly always reminds me of Joan. I think that maybe we need to share this today. And what it is what Joan wrote to us in 2002, and it was while she was on a healing journey, and it's gives us some identity of our congregation. And it's a little bit long, but I hope you'll bear with me because I just think it's beautiful. And thank you, Eloise, for sharing it. It will also be in our newsletter this week. And won't share all of it, but here's part of it. And she talks about an experience that she had. And she says, one of the events that was life-altering for me was to be given a testimony of why the church. It occurred during a week of management training for work and was quite profound in the way the lessons and learning were given. Testimony. It's a testimony from Joan. That was the word I was looking for. So I'm going back to this. I walked away with a clear understanding of the power of this particular denomination and a testimony of the hand of God in its evolution. What was made clear to me was this: we are non-creedal in that we do not have a prescribed set of dogma to which all people must subscribe. We encourage each person to develop their own testimony and stand in their personal truth. We are encouraged to be tolerant of all people and the belief systems that enable people to engage with the divine and discover their personal path. We can discuss and disagree on issues and beliefs, and yet stand in worship together lovingly, accepting all. We encourage the recognition and development of each person's giftedness and try to provide opportunities for sharing and risk-taking within the community. However, we also recognize each person's agency and right to choose when they would like to risk and to share. You can be as open or as private as you wish to be with the community, but you are welcome. We understand the need for stewardship and balancing us of our blessings and resources while giving tithing and offerings back to God. We recognize that new understandings and divine truth are ever being revealed, and so we embrace the discipline of an open canon of scripture. I could go on. And then I'm going to keep reading because I think this says also a lot about our congregation in particular. I was aware and awed then, and I am reminded now, of the individual enabling of this prophetic community. While we sometimes move slower than we would like, or we move quicker than others are comfortable, we are at least open to new understandings and personal journeys. There is room for all. So, if you are a seeker needing to know your sacred path, you are in the right church, for you are encouraged to engage and to do exactly that. If you're an activist needing to respond to the social injustices you see or the isolation of people whose needs need to be addressed, you are in the right church. For we are called to take care of the poor, heal the brokenhearted, preach deliverance to captives, recover sight of the blind, set at liberty those that are bruised, and to preach the acceptable year of the Lord. If you feel you are constantly pushing the limits of people's comfort zone by broadening the scope and spiritual understandings of the community, then you are in the right church. For we are called to be a prophetic people. If you seek simplicity and peace, you are in the right church. For we are called to create communities of joy, hope, love, and peace. I am grateful for this learning, loving community. There's a place and a call for each of you. May God continue to bless you as you respond to your heart and stand in integrity with your spirit. Stand tall. It is important to your journey, and may you find peace. Joan Strom Millard. And this will be in our newsletter this week. And thank you, Eloise, for sharing that with us. And thank you, Joan, for sharing that with us. So we're talking about butterflies and caterpillars today as we discover our identity. The transformation of the butterfly from caterpillar to chrysalis to adult butterfly is the perfect metaphor for Saul of Tarsus. And I know, Dorothy, if I say the wrong thing, she will correct me afterwards. So I'm hoping I'm using the right terminology. I think it's chrysalis, not cocoon, right?
That is a long part of it.
Okay, cocoon on this one. I didn't know it was a moth. I thought it was a butterfly. Thanks, Dorothy. So it's still, but still it's a metaphor for Saul of Tarsus. Saul was a bully. Saul, in his caterpillar stage, is that right? Okay, in his caterpillar stage, Saul ate Christians for breakfast. On his good days, he didn't like Christians. On his bad days, he was killing them. Not a fun guy. But we've learned from psychology that hate and anger, which is what Saul had, are just manifestations of fear. So maybe Saul of Tarsus was just afraid of Jesus and of this new group of people who believed that Jesus is the Messiah. So then one day on the road to Damascus, as he's walking along, Jesus came to Saul in a bright light, which blinded him. And Jesus asks, "Saul, why do you persecute me?" Well, to make a long story short, Saul laid low for a while in his chrysalis stage. And then he changed his name to Paul, became a Christian, became the face of Christianity, basically, and wrote many of the books in the New Testament. Talk about your transformation or metamorphosis. And the reason I'm talking about Paul is because our scripture today is Apostle Paul in a very interesting place. It's a scripture that I appreciate because I know this feeling well. If Jane, will you go to the scripture, please? This is from Romans 7:15 through the 25th. "I do not understand my own actions, for I do not do what I want, but I do the very thing I hate. I can will what is right, but I cannot do it. Wretched man that I am, who will receive me?" What? Rescue me. Thank you. "Thanks be to God through Jesus Christ our Lord. Thanks be to God through Jesus Christ our Lord." So last night, my newest story is, last night we were at the laser light show in Mission. There were about 100 kids running, screaming, and running all around the baseball diamond, or the baseball thing. And it was corded off because there was going to be the laser light show. And just like Paul, every kid had to go under the rope or over the rope and get inside that area just to say they did it, just because they weren't supposed to, just because they heard no. And there were all kinds of security, no, get away. And they did when they were told, and then they were right back where they shouldn't be, just because they weren't supposed to. I can relate if you've ever been on a diet. I've told not to tell me not to eat sugar, and that's all I'm going to do is eat sugar. Here's my other one. Maybe I have a prayer to share. Maybe I have a prayer to share. Here it is. "Dear Lord, so far today, Lord, I've done all right. I haven't gossiped, haven't lost my temper, haven't been greedy, grumpy, nasty, selfish, or overindulgent. I'm very thankful for that. But in a few minutes, Lord, I'm going to get out of bed. And from then on, I'm probably going to need a lot more help. Amen." This scripture, on a serious note, is what reminds me of the 12-step recovery programs. The first of the three steps are, we admitted we were powerless over whatever addiction that happens to be, that our lives had become unmanageable. Step number two, we came to believe that a power greater than ourselves could restore us to sanity. And number three, made a decision to turn our will and our lives over to the care of God as we understood him. In other words, I see this as, I can't, God can, I'm going to choose to let God. Thanks to God through Jesus Christ, our Lord. Jane, you want to go to the next slide? Dun, 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 dun. Jesus is our superhero. He's our rescue. Thanks to Jesus, we can make the choice to release our concerns and to release our whatever's holding us back and give those to God. The Lord is my shepherd, or in this case, my superhero, whichever you choose to name him today. You want to go to the next slide, Jane? When Jesus rescues us, this is what it reminds me of, Matthew 11, 28 through 30. Come to me, all you who are weary and burdened, and I will give you rest. Take my yoke upon you and learn from me, for I'm gentle and humble of heart, and you will find rest to your souls. For my yoke is easy and my burden is light. Now, in this moment, now in this day, let's choose Jesus. None of us are perfect. Well, some may be, but I'm not. So when we have a day like Paul had, and we get in our own way, how do we cope? We make a choice. That's all we have to do, is make a choice. Make a choice to turn to God. Every day is a gift of grace, or every day is a gift. That's why they call it the present, and it's a gift of grace. Our time together today is a gift from God. I know I say this every time I'm up here, just walking past the beauty of our yard is a gift of grace. When we come together in this moment of worship, we claim the gift of the Holy Spirit, that whenever two of us are gathered in his name, that he's in the middle of us. We'll go to the next slide, Jane. In Ephesians 2, we're told that we are God's handiwork. We are God's masterpieces. We belong to God. Some of the tools that help remind us that we belong to God, or that God is with us. And I'm just going to talk about a few of them that I could think of. And the first one I thought of was communion. For me, the reminder that we are the body of Christ coming together gives me a chance to focus on holiness. As we are here together, sharing our worship together, that to me is one of the tools to let us focus back on God. And I have to say, sharing worship together, sharing fellowship together, thank you to everyone who joined together on the 4th of July for our 4th of July celebration. I appreciate that we had so many of our congregation members there, and that we also were able to reach out to the community. Another way I get to focus on God when I'm in my own way is to go to prayer circle on Wednesday night. Because we come together as friends to share the love of God with each other and with those who have special needs. Prayer for me is a good way to focus. Even if I'm just talking to Jesus, and even if I'm mad talking to Jesus, just the fact that I get out of my own head and I talk to Jesus instead of just letting it roll around. And as Karen was talking about earlier, breathing, Eckhart Tolle says, you don't need to meditate for hours necessarily, just take three deep breaths like we did earlier today, and it can refocus your mind. Another one is gratitude. Philip Clancy, in his book, What's So Amazing About Grace, left the church. He was, like Paul, very well-educated and a bigwig in the church, and he left. He left the church and he left God. But the reason he came back is because he was at a lake one day, watching the sunrise, watching the birds, watching the everything around the lake, and he said, I was so overwhelmed by creation, I had nobody to thank. So he ended up going back to God, back to church. So the one thing that we've been doing this year are our spiritual practices. And the spiritual practice that we're going to do right now is a breath prayer. And I'm going to read to you what it is, and then we're going to practice it. It won't take but a minute. Breath is a sign, symbol, and a word for spirit. In the breath prayer, we breathe God's spirit in and out with a prayer phrase, just like we started this morning. One pattern is to pray of God's names that you use for God, and you breathe in, and then you breathe out, use a prayer phrase that tells God what you are wanting to talk about or what your need or longing is. For example, you breathe in, loving God, and breathe out, I want to serve you. Or pray, holy friend, as you breathe in, and breathe out, heal me. Breathe in and out. As you repeat the prayer you have discerned, now they're wanting you to do it for 5 minutes, and we're not going to do that. But what we're going to do is to have several words that we're going to focus on, and you can do it silently, and I'll read them as we breathe in and rebreathe out. Remember to focus on opening to God's presence and listening for God's voice. So, Jane, you want to go to the next slide, and we'll just breathe in and out. Okay, we're just going to do these and start with breathing in. Be still and know that I am God. We are the clay, breathe in. You are the potter. Breathe in, the light of God is in all things. Breathe in, peace be with you. Breathe in, let the spirit, breathe out, breathe. Jesus Christ, God's shalom. Breathe in, you are loved with an everlasting love. Breathe in, God yearns to draw you close. So if you choose to do that this week, focus on whatever it is, whatever the phrase is that you discern is the right phrase for you. I'm sure there are many other ways to connect and be reminded that the grace of God is with us whenever we need help. And it could be, some days we are adult butterflies. Some days we are caterpillars, but not this one. And it may be at a day when we are the chrysalis, that we just need to go inward. It may be by day, and it may be minute by minute. Each one is valid, and each one, each phase, the Holy Spirit is within us. Our job is to connect with the grace or gift of today. Our job is to connect to each other in love and grace. And it's funny because we've talked about this twice this morning already. If you watch Ted Lasso, we talked about Ted Lasso last week, but he talks about being a goldfish. And the goldfish has the shortest memory of any animal on Earth, according to Ted Lasso, which is a show on TV. The memory is 3 minutes. So he uses it in a soccer context. So if you make a mistake on the field, be the goldfish. Think about it, beat yourself up, and then let it go. Forget about it. So be the goldfish. Don't beat yourself up for the past, like Paul does in our Romans scripture, but move forward in the present and enjoy the journey. I really believe that even when we're struggling in one area of our life, we can still be an adult butterfly in other areas. And I'm going to end with a testimony about what happened to me last week. So last Saturday, I was at the funeral home, and my boss called to tell me a family was coming for a private viewing. So they got there, and normally it's the immediate family. But in this case, they walked in. They were just a lovely, lovely group. And I'm going to call the deceased Sam. As I met them at the door, they were so grateful to be there. And I learned that the family that was with me were the family that Sam, the first person they met was Sam, the deceased, when they moved into the Johnson County neighborhood. They were Black, they had a really thick accent, so I know they were hard to understand to their new neighbors. The son was the first one to talk, and he told me that he and Sam had the same name, they were the same age, and their birthdays were 1 week apart. So they were brothers. Sam was instrumental in introducing them to their entire neighborhood. And the father said he was the first person we met, and we were able to meet everyone else in our neighborhood through him. They loved this man, so much so that they are making a 13-hour drive to attend his funeral service. I felt the Holy Spirit surrounding them, just being in their presence. And I don't know anything about Sam. I don't know anything else about his life, but I do know that no matter what other struggles he had in his life, he was the beautiful butterfly to this family. As we go forward this week, may we choose to accept God's grace through Jesus Christ, the peaceful one, and boldly be God's grace to others through Jesus Christ.
Excuse me. From Doctrine and Covenants, 163, verse 9, faithful disciples respond to an increasing awareness of the abundant generosity of God by sharing according to the desires of their hearts, not by commandment or constraint. Break free of the shackles of conventional culture that mainly promotes self-serving interests. Give generously according to your true capacity. Eternal joy and peace await those who grow in the grace of generosity that flows from compassionate hearts without thought of return. Could it be otherwise in the domain of God, who eternally gives all for the sake of creation? And from Doctrine and Covenants 165, verse 6a, beloved community of Christ, do not just speak and sing of Zion, live, love, and share as Zion. Those who strive to be visibly one in Christ, among whom there are no poor or oppressed. I'd like to take this opportunity to express my gratitude for each of you as you embody these words, live, love, and share as Zion. I'm in awe of the expression of generosity from this congregation, not only in monetary gift, which you have the opportunity to share this morning, but the gifts and time and talents that you share freely. When I look around, I see expressions of love everywhere. The lawn is mowed, flower beds are weeded and watered. The kitchen and library are tended to. There are cabinets filled with fabrics and projects for community outreach, donations for Center of Hope. And then there is time spent preparing for worship services, Sunday school classes, potlucks, game night, book club, choir practices, 4th of July picnics, phone calls, cards, and visits. And then there are volunteers at Operation Breakthrough, Meals on Wheels, Center of Hope, mission trips, and I'm sure many more that I'm not aware of. I will say again, I am in awe of all that we are and all that we have to offer. Will you pray with me? Dear Lord, thank you for all the gifts and blessings you have bestowed on us, and thank you for many opportunities to express our love and compassion for others. Bless our efforts that they might bring peace and joy to each one whose lives we touch. In Jesus' name, amen.
Thank you.
Let's join together in the mission prayer. God, where will your spirit lead today? Help me be fully awake and ready to respond. Grant me courage to risk something new and become a blessing to your love and peace. Amen.